First, we join James Dean Bradfield for the story of Badfinger, Without You.
Pete Ham, who was a great writer, wrote Without You, which is like just the killer song of all time that Harry Nilsson did. But then it gets sad because then Pete went and topped himself, you know, man, you know, no need.
Well, I can't forget this evening and your face when you were leaving. But I guess that's just the way the story goes. You always smile, but in your eyes your sorrow shows. Yes, it shows.
It's become a world-famous standard, a song that sold more than 12 million copies and been covered by over 200 bands. This Badfinger song won two Ivor Novellos, yet despite huge international success, its two writers, Pete Ham and Tom Evans, both killed themselves. But what caused them to make such a tragic decision? Who or what was responsible? I'm James Dean Bradfield, and this is the story of a group which evolved from the swinging 60s Swansea music scene, who were the first act ever signed by the Beatles, who climbed to the stars before suffering a terrible string of misfortunes that to this day leave bitter feelings of resentment between surviving family and friends.
Tell me what you gonna do.
It's hard to put into words the buzz around Swansea in the late 1950s and 60s. Already a magnet for jazz and blues groups, it was second only to Liverpool for having the best rock and roll live scene outside of London. The Meteorites, the Fireflies, and the Comanceros, and the Mojos were all making waves, with The Who's Keith Moon copying the skill of the Jets drummer Bo Adams, who was arguably the first to turn the cymbals upside down and took the skin off the bass drum. There weren't enough venues to cope with the sheer number of bands. Most played six or seven nights a week. In 1964, Pete Ham and Ron Griffiths founded the Ivies, who later became Badfinger. Di Jenkins, their roadie's brother, was their rhythm guitarist, with Mike Gibbons passing an audition to become their drummer. Ron Griffiths.
It is South Wales' most closely guarded secret, some people say. I've taken friends down to Swansea and they can't believe how beautiful the surrounding area is. Now, you could tie that to the Swansea beat scene back in the 60s. Everybody was raving about Liverpool and Manchester to an extent, but Swansea had it all going for it as well. There were some marvellous bands down there, really, really good. There's still players down there today who I would class as world class, who never ever actually crossed the line and became well known, but they're still there.
Deke Leonard of the Man Band.
It was a marvellous scene, really. It paralleled the Liverpool scene, except that we had no outside record interest or a Brian Epstein to take the first one out, as it were. But it was a very, very crowded scene, a vibrant scene. There were literally thousands of bands. And the centres were like Swansea, Cardiff, Neath and Carmarthen. There was a really big gig circuit all round South Wales. I mean, there were occasional trips down to Pembroke, which we used to call a land of time forgot. It was concentrated around Swansea, really. And the Ivies were one of the bands, one of the prominent bands. They were a great band.
Only 2 miles from your door.
It was basically R&B, not what they call R&B today, but what they called R&B in those days, which was like blues-influenced rock. The venues, I mean, there were places like the Skew in Ritz, the Tivoli in Mumbles, and the bands were like the bystanders from Merthyr, who ended up as being Man. Dave Edmonds was the king of the Cardiff area, and Andy Fair with the Low and Amen Corner. And they used to come down, and we used to go up there, but it was really localised.
One of our gigs was actually in a most of weirder places. It was in a mental hospital, in Swansea called Kevin Coyd. How the heck we got the gig, I'll never know, but we were in our early days and we took anything that was going. So up we went, set all the gear up, and the funniest part of it, you know, God bless them, it wasn't their fault, but all the inmates held hands and walked round in a circle in the middle of the dance floor where we were playing.
A Townhill lad, Pete worked hard in his guitar playing. He was also a tenor whose voice blended with Ron's soulfulness. Their styles included soul, heavy blues and Motown. Their ever-improving band opened for the likes of the Spencer Davis Group and the Yardbirds. They also backed pop singer David Garrick, who Mike claimed fired them because they were getting more attention from screaming fans. The Mojo's manager Bill Collins decided to look after the Ivies as well, persuading them to move to London. Living on the breadline with £5 a week, it often came down to a choice of fags or food. Ron Griffiths again.
Well, to start with, it was a bit stretched because the Mojos were still living there and we were living up in the attic, sleeping on camp beds. But it wasn't so long before they actually went. I don't know whether it was because they were sick of us, didn't like the Welsh or what, but they eventually cleared off and we had the place to ourselves. And because the rent was hitting us, we took on an extra lodger. His name was Dave Duffield. He was the Kinks roadie at the time.
Bill Collins.
I had a good meeting with all the family out in Swansea. I said, now look, I can't promise your lads anything except blood, sweat and tears, like Winston Churchill promised us at the beginning of the war. But they've got to work and they've got to write songs. That's what it's all about. And I asked them to did our songs. No, there was a tall fella in the group. He says, I've tried, but it doesn't work. I don't know how to do it. But there's this little fat fella. He wasn't fat. Little, bonny little fella. He had a bluesy voice. Ron Griffiths. He was the bass player in the group. Ron did some fine rhythm and blues numbers. And Pete sang. They all sang. And Di Jenkins. He was a nice lad. But he couldn't hack it later on when they came to London. He couldn't hack it in the songwriting area.
A lineup change saw Scouser, Tommy Evans replacing Di Jenkins. From a musical family, a love of the Everly Brothers and Buddy Holly was evident, his lush harmonies adding yet another layer to the Ivy sound. Meanwhile, Pete was spending every spare minute in the tiny home studio attached to 7 Park Avenue. Beverly Tucker and Marianne Evans were Pete and Tom's girlfriends at this time.
The studio in 7 Park Avenue was a box. It was extremely hot, and when all the boys had been in there, when the door opened, the air came out and hit you before the boys came out. They all smoked, which obviously didn't help. Life each day. It was a drug to him. He had a lot inside him. He took notice of things he took. He read books and newspapers, and very often a song would come out of that. Anything that you told Pete went into a little filing cabinet in his mind. Very often things that had happened to any one of the group of friends, a line would come up in a song some months later, and I'd say, that's about so-and-so, and sure enough, it would be.
Here's Pete.
Well, to me, there's two kinds of writing. There's a completely personal thing, which you write about something that's happened to you or one of your own emotions. Or you can write a story, which may not have happened to you, but you can put yourself into that position. But I still like to write stories. You know, it's something I think that everybody can associate with, rather than just... To me, the scene today is getting a bit too personal, you know. Not everybody can join in with it, you know. I still think the public should be able to associate with your songs and become the highlight of the song themselves, you know. Day after
day. He was a person that thought very much about moral issues and how people live their lives and how... unjustly some people were treated. So his words always came from the heart. He wasn't so commercial in the way that Tom was. Tom knew how to work the business. He knew what would work, what would be something that people would sing along to. That was something Pete had to learn. He was very instinctive with his writing. The two together balanced very well.
Tom and Pete had a good relationship. They were very close, and Pete moved in the same neighborhood than we lived. They wrote songs together. Nearly every day they saw each other, writing songs up in the attic. Pete was his best friend. He was the closest friend he had. Tom had a lot of respect for Pete.
Marianne Evans. The sheer quality of songs being produced by Pete and his newfound writing partner, Tommy, was soon picked up. Beatles roadie Mal Evans was a friend of Bill Collins. George and John liked the Ivy's material, but McCartney was the most impressed. The boys were the first band to officially sign to the Beatles' Apple label. Here's Tommy.
Paul McCartney's dad used to play in a dance band, and this manager we had, Bill Collins, used to be in a rival dance band in Liverpool in the 30s. So we knew McCartney's dad. He said, I think I'll go down to Abbey Road. I think they're going to make in probably Sergeant Pepper. They're all out of their heads on acid or whatever, you know. And this old grey-haired guy goes in there smoking a pipe. So we just put a big box of tape, 500 songs in a box and sent them to Apple. I think they must have gone through one tape, and McCartney came back and said, well, yeah, I like the ideas and everything, but there's no singles there, you know, keep on. So we just carried on doing what we were doing. And in the end, it was Lennon, actually. He said, yeah, we'll sign Lennon and Harrison. He said, we'll sign them.
Well, that was absolutely marvellous. I can't begin to describe how we felt. You know, we were just elated.
Being on the Apple label, it's strange because people think that we, like, set out to copy the Beatles or be like the Beatles. But we do that. We do the music we do because we like that kind of music, you know. And I think it's... we're pretty... commercially minded, and as far as the melody sense, you know, as far as the melody goes, and it's that that really helps, I think, a record to make it.
Maybe tomorrow I will love again. I'll never know until I've seen her once or twice. And so I'm living for a dream. Each lonely day spent looking for the sunshine.
The first producer we had there was Tony Visconti, who's now married and producing Mary Hopkin and T-Rex.
I was employed by Apple Records to make the Ivies album, and we got so far into it, and we actually had a hit in America called Maybe Tomorrow. And it went really high. It was my first big American hit, as a matter of fact, and it took me completely by surprise because I really didn't rate it much. Then after about recording eight tracks, I don't know, for one reason or another, I can't remember the conditions, but we sort of split up. But before we did, I always used to look down and watch Pete and Tom. I had to look out the window and see if it was Pete and Tom singing because they sounded exactly like Lennon and McCartney. And Badfinger had this... a lot of people in America actually thought Badfinger was just another name for the Beatles. It was another guise for the Beatles. But Peter and Tom had those kind of voices. I suppose Tom coming from Liverpool. I don't know what it made them sing that way. But one day I looked up from my desk as I was mixing a Badfinger track, and I looked up over the desk, and there was McCartney staring me right in the face. And I hadn't known him yet. It was the very first time I met Paul McCartney. And he was still in the Beatles. Of course, the Beatles were still together in those days. And he said, oh, excuse me, I thought we were recording here today. We must be recording at Abbey Road. But I'll just hang around for a little bit and have a listen. After all, he owned the group. He owned the record label. So I can't tell you. I went into complete shakes from that moment on. I never expected to look up and see McCartney 2 feet from my face, just sort of with his arms folded across on the desk, just watching me mix.
We didn't know it, but Paul McCartney had dropped into the studio upstairs in the mixing room, and he was listening to what we'd done, and he came down, set the mic, hey, I like that.
The Badfinger story on BBC Radio Wales. I'm James Dean Bradfield. McCartney himself was convinced that Maybe Tomorrow, with its lavish string arrangement, was a surefire British hit. But it was buried under a pile of Christmas releases. Pete Townshend offered them his song, Mary Ann with a Shaky Hand, but Pete refused. Both he and Tom were crushed by the lack of domestic success. To give them a start, McCartney offered them Come and Get It, something he'd written for a new Peter Sellers film, The Magic Christian. They laid it down in 3 hours at Abbey Road, all the time being taught how to keep things simple. Here's Paul McCartney.
Mal was our roadie. Mal brought Badfinger to Apple. And he said, great band, you know. And he'd kind of discovered them. And I listened to him and said, great band. So they're going to need a hit, you know. So like one night, I kind of was in bed and I couldn't go to sleep. So just ran downstairs and had this little idea and did the rough idea for Come and Get It. And then we were set up to make a Beatles album. Can't remember which one it was. We were set up. So we were all in the studio. The drums were mic'd. Everything was mic'd for the next day, you know, on the album. So I just ran in, because I live real near the studio, so I just ran in, and Phil McDonald was the engineer. I said, Phil, everyone's going to get here in half an hour. I said, look, just before they get here, I want to do a quick demo. I said, I know exactly what I want to do. Get the mics, go now, get it, drums first. And I kind of knew how it worked. Right, piano, dun 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 dun, bass, dun dun dun. If you want it, here it is. Honey, come and get it. And Phil nearly had a heart attack, but we in about half an hour, I think, we made that demo. I said to Badfinger, I said, now it's got to be exactly like this. And they were kind of young band. They said, well, no, we want to do it a little bit different. We want to get our own thing, you know, Welsh boys. I said, no. I said, do the rest of the album like that. But this has got to be exactly like this, because this is the hit. And you know, in the end they did. Oh, all right. I said, well, look, the B-side and everything else, the whole rest of the album, you really shine. And so, you know, we did get a big number one hit, which introduced them, you know, to the world.
Despite going top five in both Britain and the States, band disharmony was rife. Ron, who was married and living with the band, together with his newborn son, was put under pressure to leave by Tommy.
Well, Tommy Evans couldn't handle the fact that I was married. I don't know whether he was jealous because Maureen was a good looker, I've no idea. But he found it hard to come to terms with. And he poisoned the other lads' minds, I think. Ron's not one of the boys anymore. We'd go away on the road for days on end, if not a week. And I'd come back, and I'd naturally want to spend time with Maureen and my young son. And he couldn't accept or cope with that. So it just created bad blood. He'd have his stereo on in the early hours of the morning, wake the baby up, which would naturally cause friction between Maureen and myself. You know, I was forced to go and have a go at him, and it just got worse and worse and worse. And in the end, it became a no-win situation. I couldn't actually... He wouldn't accept that I was very much a part of the band and I hadn't lost interest. I think he wanted me out and he just used that as a lever.
Apple felt a name change was needed. As Mike reveals, John Lennon was in short of suggestions.
The name had to go. And John Lennon, everybody put their penny in to get a name. He wanted to call us the pronounced pricks. P-R-I-X. That's what he meant.
The Glass Onion was another one of his.
The Cagneys, they wanted to call us the Cagneys because we were little punks.
The Beatles had a minor, or is it a B-side or a demo or something, which was called Badfinger Boogie, and that's where that came from. Not one of my favourite names.
So we said, I'm tired of looking for a name. Let's use that. It doesn't matter.
Ron's replacement was Scouser Joey Molland. Much like Joe Walsh joining the Eagles, he gave Badfinger a harder edge, vital for the American market. He also had a knack for a good hook. Driver, driver, go too fast. Miser, miser, make it last. Pusher, pusher, on the run. It's all inside a game we've been playing for so long, so long. band chemistry was now extraordinary. Pete's driving force, Tom's melting harmonies, Mike's rock-steady drumming, and Joey's rock and roll grit. Badfinger's first album, No Dice, hit the American Top 30. But the big surprise was the song Without You. Written for Beverly by Pete on a hook dreamed up by Tommy, it wasn't even released as a single. Yet a cover version by Harry Nilsson shot to number one in Britain, America, and Canada. It's also been covered by Shirley Bassey, Mariah Carey, and Cilla Black, to name but a few.
No, I can't forget this evening, or your face as you were leaving, but I guess that's just the way the story goes.
Beverly has mixed feelings on the song today.
Pete had been working in the studio for about 2.5-3 weeks, solidly, writing stuff for a new album. The boys were also working, and I'd barely seen him, and we had one day when Pete said, right, this day we're going out. I promise you, I'm not going to write. We haven't got a gig that night. We'll go out for the evening. And so we got ready, and we were really looking forward to our night out. And just as we got into the hall, Tom poked his head around the door and said, I've got an idea for a song. Can you come into the studio with me? And Pete immediately said, no, I've promised Bev we're going out tonight. I've barely seen her. Tom obviously looked a bit dejected, and I looked at Pete and thought, well, it's silly. You know, I just said to him, no, it's okay, it's fine. Go ahead, go into the studio, because I knew that's what he loved doing. And it would have been very difficult. He would have been thinking about Tom, or should I have stayed? I just said, I'm fine about it. And he said, no, I promised. And I said, no, look at me, I'm smiling, I'm fine. And he just turned round and looked at me and said, your mouth's smiling, but your eyes are sad.
You always smile, but in your eyes your sorrow shows.
That was the line that ultimately, slightly changed, of course, was in the song.
Here's Tommy.
The bit I had was like help. But it's basically, in essence, mostly the chorus bit, you know? And he just had this other bit. He said, we should stick those together and that. We got in the studio and we were doing it, and I said, I don't like this, it's too corny, you know? I really didn't like it. Just disregarded it. And then we're working with Todd Rundgren in our studios, and Nilsson comes in and said, I've got this song I want you to hear. And I didn't know, I knew who Nilsson was, but I didn't know him personally. And he came in and introduced himself. And he took us to the mixing room. So I want you to hear this, and then he played Without You, and that really showed me what you can do with a song production-wise, and, you know, with a good singer, you know. And it just blew me away.
And that was the first they even knew it had happened. And Pete said it was, you know, you heard it, and it's such a well-produced, well-sung thing. It was brilliant and out of the blue. Then that was a hit. But it will be a hit every 5 years for somebody, I think.
I was at a party one night in Laurel Canyon, and you know, I was sitting on the floor playing records, and somebody played this song, and I thought it was Lennon. I mean, without you know, I thought that little thing. The next day, I called my friend, and I said, what was that? That song that had, you know, in it, you know? He says, what? I said, you know, it's like a Beatles song, it's like a Lennon thing. He said, geez, I know which one you mean, but I can't think of it. And everyone remembered that, but no one remembered the song. And we're all going through all the Beatle collections, and I said, I know, it's not the Beatles, it's the other one, Grapefruit, you know, and it's not them. And finally, somebody said, Badfinger. I said, Badfinger? Oh, that's it. And then we found Without You. So I took it to Richard Perry, the producer, and said, hey, Richard, I think I found one. He said, oh, Harry, I think you have.
Tommy Evans, the Man Band's Deke Leonard, and Harry Nilsson there. To the outsider, it didn't look as if Badfinger could put a foot wrong. But in August 1970, an American music business manager sweet-talked Bill Collins into doing business with him. This would be a turning point for the band, but not for the right reasons.
No matter what.
no matter what. We had Down in the Can for a year. Because after we had Come and Get It out, they said, well, go on, do another single. So we did Believe Me and No Matter What, and presented, Alan Klein had taken over then, presented it to Klein, and he said, I don't think it's a single, you know, go and carry on. And we said, it is a single. So that was there for a year.
I remember buying a copy of No Matter What in a car boot sale when I was 17 years old. I remember learning it on guitar. I wasn't aware that Badfinger had a Welsh history at that point. I just thought it was a great rock song. In December of 1970, with a single, No Matter What, hammering up the British charts to number 5, reaching number 8 in the States, Badfinger were on a roll. Even John Lennon had asked them to play with him. Here's Tommy Evans and Mike Gibbons.
Joey and I played acoustics, you know. George was still into his acoustic trip, and he persuaded John to get us to go down and play for John, you know. And John wasn't so keen on it as George was, you know. He said, what's all that acoustic shit, man? I don't need all that. Making fairies, playing the guitar. And we played on Jealous Guy, you know. He did it in about 3 takes. We just sang it live, you know.
I was told when I was 22 years old by an accountant that I can fart on the next record, We Millionaires. And I remember phoning my dad going, everything's cool. Boom. Right? That was a pipe dream right there. And I'm told by professional pinstripes that's the case. And they were blowing smoke up my butt, you know? You know, so you know, the rest of that is like, you know, a nightmare.
Behind the scenes, the seeds of the band's destruction were being sown. American Stan Polley was desperate to sign them, aware of their Beatles link with the subsequent earning potential. The late Bill Collins always defended his lack of business experience. This was in the days before modern music management companies. Bill, who was Badfinger's general manager, didn't ask an outside lawyer to look at the contract Polley offered, giving him 30% of all gross earnings, at a time when business managers only received around 5%. This proved to be a calamitous error in the years to come. Here's Bill Collins and Beverly Tucker.
I'm not legal-minded. I'm not a businessman. I have to do it on feel and trust to satisfy myself. You might say that was a poor show for the group I was looking after. But they had a chance to take it to lawyers. I told them, it was all discussed.
Tom, in particular, was worried, and Pete just kept saying, it will be all right. I trust Bill, it will be all right. And Tom said, and he was ultimately to be proved right, this time it's out of his league. He just doesn't know how to cope with this situation.
I found out we were getting robbed really bad, you know. And I just overlooked it and just thought, well, the best thing to do is just carry on, you know. But Peter is the type of person who, if he put his trust in someone, he would feel humiliated if he was wrong, you know. He's a very stubborn type of guy.
At this time, Apple was in turmoil. But George Harrison asked the boys to work on his All Things Must Pass solo album. He also asked Badfinger to be his backing band for his concert for Bangladesh at Madison Square Garden on October the 1st, 1971. It was the world's first ever rock benefit concert of its kind, raising $15 million. Pete played a duet with George on Here Comes the Sun. Here's Pete.
It was great. It was really tremendous. It must have been the band of the century, really, you know, when you think about it. I mean, Dylan coming out as well. We hadn't been in New York for so long. It was a good band anyway, especially considering the small amount of rehearsal time that was available. Liam and Eric Clapton came in like the night before. They didn't have any rehearsal. And, like, we rehearsed George, Jim Keltner, Ringo, and the horn section, Billy Preston and Klaus. We rehearsed for about 4 days.
Badfinger spent the next 15 months touring constantly. The Iceland gigs in particular were boisterous. The man band's Deke Leonard again.
All the women were tall, beautiful and Nordic, and all the men were short, ginger and hobbit-like. So we, with our carnal persuasions, waded into the local populace and upset the Icelanders. And there were lots of fights. I remember we used to have fights all the time, and they, you know, you can't fight without your boots on, you know. Whereas they seemed to have their sort of Icelandic version of the Queensbury rules, and they thought when we started kicking them, they started complaining. And they were standing up, you know, with their fists cocked and all that sort of stuff. So there were lots of fights, and the fight I remember is a real free-for-all, a real John Wayne kind of swinging on the chandeliers job. And Bill Collins, Badfinger's manager, who was about 30 years older than us, tried to step in to stop the fight, which was a reasonable thing to do. But as he stepped in, I started this punch. There was a melee in front of me, and an Icelandic head popped out of the top of it, so I thought, I'll knock this man's head off. And the punch started low, but before it got to him, Bill Collins stepped out, and the punch hit him right in the solar plexus, knocked all the wind out of his body, and he collapsed. And Pete and Mike were standing next to me, and they burst out laughing when it happened, so I felt guilty of myself and for decking Bill, but I seem to have Badfinger's approval.
Badfinger's Straight Up album went down a storm with fans. It would later be hailed as a classic, with record collectors today clamouring for its re-release. The single, Day After Day, chalked up 1 million sales in the US alone. But the band was still barely making ends meet, thanks to Stan Polley's financial management. Badfinger left Apple, enticed by a lucrative deal with Warner Brothers, worth more than $3 million. Pete hated the pressure of 2 albums per year over 3 years, whereas the ever-perceptive Tommy was extremely weary. Lou Christie was a successful 60s singer who was also looked after by Stan Polley. To this day, he still resents the way he was treated by him.
Well, he controlled everything. He controlled all of your money. Don't worry about it. We'll pay the bills. We'll pay the house bill or whatever it was, the apartment, or, you know, I had bought in a house along with my songwriting partner Twyla, and you know, he was supposed to be paying all these bills and send them, you know, the mortgage in or something, you know, and things started, you know, 2-3 months he didn't do it, then they were foreclosing on the house, and it was demoralizing after a while. You know, you think, my God, I gotta go ask, you know. I remember, I don't think Peter had a pair of shoes. I think his shoes were wearing out or something like that. And his girlfriend was pregnant, and they were expecting a child, and he couldn't get any money. And that was the same thing he was doing with all the Badfinger. You know, he was controlling the money. He just said, if you try to get away from me, it'll never work. He says, because you'll spend all of your time fighting me for, you know, what you think you want, you need, and blah, blah, blah. He said, but you'll never be creative after that, because you'll be chasing me, anyone who tries to come after me. You'll be chasing me, and you'll be so obsessed with that that you'll never be able to create, because obviously when you're a creative person, you have to have this open feeling, and, you know, and the first time it really hit the papers really bad is when he was indicted with a Supreme Court judge of New York. He avoided going to jail about 4 times, you know. But there were so many stories one after another about this man. And we all believed this. We all believed in this man. He was so convincing.
You're listening to Without You, the Badfinger Story on BBC Radio Wales. I'm James Dean Bradfield. Amidst growing clamours of where is the money, 2 Badfinger albums were released within 3 months of each other by 2 different labels. The Ass album on Apple and Badfinger on Warner. A bitter court case ensued, centred on overdue royalties that Polley claimed Apple owed him. Both albums didn't sell. On their 6th US tour, Badfinger were reduced to playing colleges. 1974 saw a new album, Wish You Were Here. It received fantastic reviews, being classic pop rock with a progressive edge, completely of its moment. Despite all this good work in the studio, another court battle loomed, with publishing company WB Music demanding Polly told the whereabouts of their $100,000 advance. Here's Dan Matavina, author of the definitive Badfinger book, Without You.
Ed Silvers ran Warner Brothers' publishing arm in the U.S., and he had sensed something was up, and he became extremely agitated. And he informed Joe Smith, who was the president of Warner Brothers Records, of the situation. Originally, Stan Polly had been contractually obligated to put the entire amount of this advance in an escrow account. But unbeknownst to everyone, Polly had started a money laundering scenario, spreading this advance into many different banks. Now, over the past few years, the group had become dissatisfied with most of their creative and business situations. They couldn't quite understand their career path, where their money was going, and Bill Collins couldn't get them straight answers.
Stan Polly started to do things that I didn't like. But by that time, I'd had a split group. Joey was starting to feel his strength. He'd met this girl, Kathy Wiggins. Kathy Wiggins, what a... She started to blow stuff into his head. And Joey changed his nature. A different Joey came out. Miserable, untalkative, secretive. When she took over Joey Mullen's life and mine, and she took it over, in my opinion, one wanted to go one way, another wanted to go the other, split up group, oh Christ, what's going on here? Kathy Wiggins, she was at the bottom of it all.
Bob Jackson.
Now there were five of us, and I thought, well, this is fantastic, this is the original band, plus me, I can add extra harmonies, add all the piano and organ parts that they could never have done live, you know, they did an album, so how can it fail? You know, this is great. From my point of view, it seemed that Pete was deferring everything to Joey at that point. I wondered why, and found out from Tommy and Mike later on, during, as the gigs went on and as we talked more, and I was stopping at Tom's house a lot, and he explained that there'd been this big argument between Joey's wife also, Kathy, who's a very, very confident, strong-minded girl, and Pete. Apparently, Kathy was getting more and more involved, both musically and business-wise, managerially, in the group. And the last thing Pete wanted to do was to be managed by the girlfriend of one of the guys. You know, it just... But when it came to a crunch, when he sort of raised it and it raised into an argument, apparently Joey sort of just wanted him out. And Pete, being Pete, just said, well, you know, right, OK, I'm off, I'm gone. And he was. I mean, he would have stayed out. The reason he came back, and I think this is a much misunderstood thing, that he came back entirely unselfishly. He came back because he was told, apparently, that the band would suffer terribly if he wasn't in it. You know, the record deal would go down, you know, the work would go down. The best thing he could do for everyone, really, was to come back, you know, rejoin. But when he came back, he certainly didn't come back on his terms.
The last time I saw him was at a Wings gig in Hammersmith Odeon, and he was almost whispering, his voice, he lowered his voice to the point that I had kept saying to him, you know, repeat that, Peter, I didn't hear that. It seemed to kind of gone back into himself, really. He was all, he wasn't the usual Pete.
Bob Jackson, Bill Collins and Deke Leonard there. Pete rejoined the band, but he wasn't himself. Bob Jackson again.
This new album we'd done, Head First, and even the last album wasn't going to come out. We couldn't see our way forward, and the money started drying up too. The checks, the monthly checks, started drying up. Now, Pete, on a personal level, had extra pressures. He just bought, after all these hits and successes, he'd only just bought his first house. His partner, Anne, was having a kiddie. It was his first child. You know, can you imagine what was going on in that guy's head? He was renovating this house himself, by the way. He's putting JCBs... You know, honestly, I got a real insight into things because he invited me down and this was just the week before he died. He invited me down for a whole week because we never really spent any real social time together, not really. Time in pubs, yeah, and in the studio, but not. Anyway, really nice of him. I was made up, you know. I managed to have some long talks with him through the night. You know, we played songs and we chatted and we agonised, and he was getting really worried. He could see the money was dried up and all these successes they had going to come to nothing. And so he was, yeah, he was rapidly going downhill. And it was also becoming more apparent, by the way, he used to have a habit of stubbing out cigarettes on his hand, and this got more and more frequent toward the end.
On April 24th, 1975, Pete Ham killed himself.
For I can't bear to feel the sorrow of the evil that you've shown.
His daughter, Petra, was born 5 weeks later. Marianne Evans.
I remember the phone went at 6 a.m, and it was Anne. And Tommy was, he drove over there. He went into the garage and he found Pete, and it was horrible. It was sad. It was like a nightmare for everybody.
The last thing he said to me is, I'll see you again. At 5 o'clock, his wife gets on the phone to me, screaming, and Peter's dead, you know. So I went there, and she hadn't phoned the police, and that's all I know, you know.
I got this telegram from Tom, ring me. So I rang him, and he said, Pete's dead. I said, what are you talking about? He said he'd been found hung in his garage.
Oh, Jesus. What have I done? I shouldn't have started bad thing in the first case.
I knew there were better things yet to come, to be done. It makes me sad when I think of me and you. I can't forget the
It's hard to sort of put it into words, really. I was knocked sideways with it. Tommy was obviously knocked sideways as well. We all were, you know what I mean? It was just such a shock. I mean, now I wonder why I didn't see it coming. But anyway, I went down straight away, caught a train, found out that Pete had seen Tommy the night before, and they'd had a drink together, and Peter just said, I know a way forward, I know what to do, I know what I've got to do, you know. And Pete, again, Tommy didn't guess, but that was it.
With no respect for Pete's memory, Stan Polley immediately attempted to collect on a $250,000 life insurance policy he'd secretly set up, with himself as beneficiary. To this day, no one knows if he collected the money. Meanwhile, Badfinger's record deal was brought to an abrupt end in November 1975. Always content with simply trying to be happy in life, drummer Mike Gibbons went back to South Wales, where he rejoined the music scene, often playing with Bonnie Tyler. Sadly, he died in 2005, but his wife Ellie confirms what many fans believe, in that his songwriting talent went untapped throughout his days with Badfinger.
Mike was actually a very good songwriter, but very much overlooked, since obviously Pete was the main songwriter. Tommy was also a very strong songwriter. All the things that I know about Mike and the type of person that he was, I believe because of like his sense of humor, which is what got him through all the bad times in life. And there were many, not just with Badfinger, as life goes on with everybody. But he just always felt a change is as good as a rest, or if you think different thoughts, things will change. So he always tried to maybe speak to the guys and try to make something fun out of something bad, to try and give them a different perspective on what might be going on at the time.
love you. Don't cry. Think of the good times we knew. Time flies just like a fine wine will bloom.
Badfinger was Pete and Tom, but Badfinger were four. It was Mike, Joe, Pete, and Tom. And that's the way it should always be remembered.
Tom and Bob formed the Dodgers, and there was a brief Badfinger reconciliation when Elektra gave them a deal, but it wasn't to be. More tension with Joey led to a final split. Tommy's mental state quickly went into freefall.
I have a vendetta against Joey Marl right now. I've given so much credence. He broke the band up. Oh, he's done a lot of things. But now it's over. It's dead. It takes an awful lot for me to get pissed off.
I would
sue me for the Apple money from without you and all that. Bastard. That guy's gone too far.
He was very upset. Everything in generally. Disappointed with life. Tommy would say one day, I'll be up where Pete is. It's a better place than down here.
Tommy Evans took his own life on November 19th, 1983.
Well, Stephen came in the bedroom and he said, "Where's Daddy?" And then he went outside and he saw his father and he woke my girlfriend up and he said, "There's someone who looks like my father." And he came to me and I looked. And then I ran out to the neighbors and I can't remember anything. For the next weeks, I was under shock.
I'm not over you. Oh no, I'm not over you. Oh no, I'm not over you. Oh no, I'm not over you.
Tom never recovered from losing Pete. He'd lost his friend. He'd lost the person that he felt most comfortable with working work-wise. He felt deserted, poor Tom, and he was brilliant. He was so good to everybody else, trying to keep their spirits up. He was wonderful to me, and I bless him for that. But he just didn't recover, and he used to say sometimes, "I want to be where Pete is." But we didn't ever think that he would do the same thing, knowing the pain and the sadness and the anguish of family and friends after Pete died. We really, really didn't think that Tom would do that as well.
But Badfinger wasn't allowed to rest in peace. 2 years later, a vicious court case ensued, with Joey Molland, Bill Collins and Mike Gibbons all requesting a share of the annual royalties of Pete and Tom's international hit, Without You, which to this day is worth more than $400,000 a year in royalties. Here's Dan Mazzavino again.
The court proceeding was set up to finally resolve the disputes over all matter of Badfinger's past, present, and future artists, publishing, and songwriting royalties. But the major component was the songwriting royalties of Pete and Tom's Without You, because even at that time it was clearly a worldwide ballad standard covered by hundreds of artists, and its performance and airplay royalties would sustain economically endlessly. Now Tom's widow Marianne and Anne, the mother of Pete's daughter, they were being pressured by their lawyers to settle the matter to stop the bleed of legal fees. And Ron Griffiths, a founding member of the band who was on many of the Badfinger recordings, was not even told of the proceedings and had no chance to gainfully acquire any rights, even to his own songs. Just before this judge was to finalize everything, the lawyers congregated and settlements were resolved for all matters, including all five of them sharing in each other's songwriting. Conceivably, this could have been fought by Hammond Evans' lawyers because nothing had ever been agreed to in writing and signed off on, as Bill Collins verified at the time.
When the court case was coming on, I said, "Look, I could go for 20%, but I'll tell you that we had a verbal deal between us. We never started put down the paper, but that's the deal that morally stands between us."
The ill feeling continued a decade later when ASCAP, the American body charged with collecting musical royalties, held an annual dinner presenting awards to Joey, Mike and Bill for co-writing Without You with Pete and Tommy.
Last year, Marie Carey gave it her special touch. The song is Without You. And the writers are Thomas Evans, Peter Hamm, William Collins, Michael Gibbons, and J.C. Holland. The publisher is Warner Chappell Music. We are thrilled to have the members of the group Badfinger with us tonight from England. William Collins, Michael Gibbons, and J.C. Holland.
Mullen.
Thank you very much for that.
Soundbite number one. This is a great situation here. Some of the greatest songwriters in the world all around us here, just unbelievable. And here we are eating dinner, it's fantastic. This is fantastic.
I couldn't believe it till the last minute when they announced a songwriter and their names were on a big screen, there are five songwriters, and saying, we wrote Without You. It was just one of the worst moments in my life.
There was far too many people up accepting an award that wasn't for them, basically. I mean, it was ASCAP that made the mistake. And the only two people that should really have been up accepting it are obviously, they're not here today, but the people that should have been up there should have been myself, Stephen, who is Tom Evans' son, Mariana, who is obviously Tom Evans' wife, and my mum, Anne, as well. I mean, they're the people that should have been there, and I just feel it's wrong. I mean, I understand that they're in the band as well, but they didn't write without you, so they shouldn't have been up there accepting it. And I just feel there was an awful lot of bad things said at the time as well, afterwards, about especially about Stephen. I mean, I wonder what they would have said about myself if I had been there.
Tom's wife, Marianne, and Petra Hamm there. We asked Joey and Kathy Mullen to contribute to this documentary, but they didn't get back to us. However, it's worth noting that in 1991, Polly was convicted of defrauding inventor Peter Brock of $250,000. Brock's marriage broke up and his children's education was ruined. But Polly never returned the money. It's very sad how Badfinger today are overshadowed by their litigious history. Despite having been handled with extreme unprofessionalism, disrespect and cruelty, they still managed to record some outstanding songs, real modern standards, as well as influencing a new generation of Welsh bands such as the Super Furry Animals and the Manic Street Preachers. They never really got the chance to truly mature as a band, and I think that's a real tragedy.
When I hear the song today, I have a mixture, really, of emotions. I'm very proud of it, but it does make me feel sad because I do sometimes think if it hadn't been written, then maybe Pete and Tom might still be here. So it's difficult. It's lovely to hear it. I've heard it all over the world in various places, in Africa, in Greece, you know, just, and it's lovely, but it's always going to be tinged by sadness, really.
I only wish that it hadn't come to that. What I really feel sore about is I never ever really, although I was on early recordings, I was never in the band when Pete's songwriting came of age. That's what I really, really miss.
It's got, yeah, it's the music, isn't it? I mean, those songs have got a life of their own. And they'll last and bring joy forever. And, of course, Badfinger, in a kind of genre-like way, they were right at the head of that power pop thing. You know, it just wasn't just the Beatles or, you know, this was like more, you know, heavier guitars, a heavier, bigger sound, but still with the pop sensibility, you know?
And you feel sad because it's such a beautiful song, and you feel angry what it all did. That two people had to die, mainly because of all the business around it, you know.
They were obviously capable of writing songs that captured the public ear. You know, I've written thousands of songs, but none of them has kind of really, you know, I'm a minority artist, as it were. But they captured the public mood, and the fact that with Without You, it's a standard. I'm not saying the band would have lasted forever, but they could have kept on going and writing songs, and with that they were likely to have more hits, and well, we'll never know, will we? We'll never know.
Without You, the story of Badfinger, was presented by James Dean Bradfield and was a Demos production for BBC Radio Wales.